keep things at a discussion level because our labs were not ready, right? So we were still working on making the labs available till evening. So that was also one reason why we did have a lot of other discussions also. But it is always good to know that why do you need RAC? Why do you need disaster recovery? Because as a developer, if you just develop and do not worry about what is happening around, you will remain a developer. Usually people want to grow into architects, and architect has to know bigger pictures. So that is why I try to introduce, but it's up to each of us how you utilize that information. But if it is taking too much time, just remind me so that we can reduce it sometimes. Hopefully from today it won't happen because our labs are ready. Is everybody's lab is ready? Everybody saw the red screen? Anybody who did not see the red screen, I'll come to your desk and we'll figure it out what needs to happen. All right, so architecture. But we will get into detailed performance things starting from today. More than, I don't think discussions will not reduce, but we will have a lot of lab. Okay. Thank you, Chetana. It's good to know from the feedback from your side as well. So where are we going? Yes, Narendra. I'm just adding a plus one for your topic so that you spend lesser time. That's it. Any questions? So whether you have something useful to remind, or you remember something, or you have something to add to a topic or ask about a topic, anything, just you can talk about it. OEM? The DB replay, which is also referred to as database replay. That is extremely useful, yes. So we'll see if one of the days I can show you how to access it and how to make it work. We'll try that. Yes, Raghavendra. Yes. What was that?
Physical, logical.
Physical versus logical, yes. Yes. So you can never imagine, or you cannot let anybody else also imagine that this should happen in this much time, unless you have something to compare with. And if you don't, then run it with an open mind and assume that this is the best. And starting from there, you can ask for suggestions from BBAs or maybe your colleagues that can we improve this in any manner. But then you cannot expect that it will happen in this much time. Yes. So that was the layers of performance. So first one is the application itself, then you have the database software, then we have the memory area, and finally storage. And the tuning should also happen in the same sequence, same direction. So we start with the application and then go one by one if needed. So it's not that you have to always come to the storage level. Storage is the last, and you may not reach the storage level a lot of times. Not every performance issue has to go up to storage level. Right? You may be able to fix things from application side or from database software side itself. All right. What else?
And again, when you will go for different DB instances?
Yes. So that was rack.
Yeah.
Why more instances? So why more instances?
Availability. High availability.
And I got. What else?
Performance.
Do you add more instances for performance? Rack will not help you with performance. So if your queries are running at whatever level today, tomorrow if you add a rack environment to the same, it doesn't help you with performance. It will help you with scalability. So same things more people will be able to do. That is scalability and availability. Parallelism is one thing that you will get. That is. So scalability. But see, parallelism is not something that is not available without rack. You can have parallelism on the standalone environments also. As long as you have more than one CPU on your servers. And that is usually the case. Even laptops have octa-cores today. So, parallelism will be available on most of the environments. But with rack, you will just have more CPUs to work with. That is one possibility. Yes.
We also mentioned that the number of queues are like high availability.
Yeah.
Suppose an application has 10 connections
mm-hmm.
to the database, and that is the permitted limit for an instance.
Okay.
And we need to run some more jobs with the same application. So, in that aspect, can we not consider it as performs better in like adding more jobs to the application?
See, when you are saying an application can have 10 connections to the database, so that you are assuming that it opens 10 connections to the database and keeps them.
Mm-hmm.
That's what you mean?
Yes. Meaning the existing 10. Over that, if we want to do anything additional,
on it through the same connections.
Not same connection. Like
above 10.
So then we connect to another instance and then start
doing. Oh.
Does it not say it improved the...
That way, yes, you can say it can help with performance, yes. Yeah, yeah. See, I am not rejecting any idea.
Okay.
I want you to come up with in which scenarios that can help with performance, and this is one where you are mentioning that application is limited in some sense, and then when you increase the number of connections, then it can do more with extra connections. So essentially it becomes scalability, but you want to see it as performance. See, when we call something as a performance benefit, when whatever was happening yesterday, after you got rack, it improved. But that won't change here. You are just going to
be,
timing would be the same. But you will be able to do more things.
Yes.
That is correct. You will be able to do more things.
The slowdown would be reduced in case if there is a load. When it comes to the performance, maybe the timing
could be.
Is the same, but maybe there was an the slowdown might have been avoided at that point.
What slowdown?
In a sense, like because of the too much of CPU usages.
Hmm.
In case if you don't consider number of other instances. Then there is a chance that because of the CPU, your performance might have come down. Like
it is possible, yes, due to workload. So if a single instance is getting all of those 10 connections and they are hogging all the resources, now if you distribute with rack instances, maybe the sessions will benefit. Yeah. So that is why we talked about scalability. When do you think of scalability? So let's say you do not have a need for a HA, high availability immediately, and you do not need more users to log in. But your resource usage on the current servers is still going to 90% every day. All CPUs, memory, disk, everything is going to 90%. This is also one reason you would want to have a rack, which means add another instance, so that now you can distribute your resources a little more. So now with the new rack, one more instance if you add, then that 90% will come down to close to 40-50% on each, because rack distributes the loads completely equally. So that way you will have a more scope within the same servers to grow more. You can allow more connections later on once you bring down your resources, usage of resources. So that is also one scalability factor, not just adding more users but being able to reduce the load on the servers. Good, that is a useful rack concern. What else? We are still talking to Raghavendra, right? Okay, so you are a book?
No.
Okay, keep going. And don't worry, it's not that he is taking up your topics, because you can repeat. If you have something to add or you want to ask something, you can still mention the same thing. So it's not a problem. Yes, Raghavendra. Yes. Redo, undo, log writer, database writer, checkpoint. Dirty purple blocks. What else? Then any comments about any of these? The processes, checkpoints, dirty blocks, redo, undo. Okay. Rakesh.
Yeah, I would start off with that log writer and database writer. That concept, like how it uses the checkpoint to write it into the storage and how it maintains in the memory. That concept was new for me, so I didn't know. So that was interesting. And apart from that, the concept of rack.
And do you understand the logic?
Yes.
Only when the change that you are trying to do, an update statement, insert statement, once for every change, Oracle creates a redo. Redo is utilized if you ever had to do the same change again. So first it has to record this somewhere. That is why log writer does its work first. Then it tells the DB writer that, okay, now I am done. I have recorded the change. Now go ahead and write your dirty blocks, whatever you have. So if you understand why is it happening, you don't have to mug up anything, that why log writer runs first or database writer runs first. You understand that this is why it is happening. And that becomes easy. It will remain with you forever. You don't have to refer to notes or books anymore. Yes, go ahead.
Is that the same reason why when we run the update for the first time, it might take some time, but the second time when we run the update, because it's already there in the logs, it's able to process it faster?
What is there in the logs?
The update statement, whatever I have issued.
Statement is there, yes. So it is a little faster, because if you are issuing the same statement,
yes,
maybe with changed values, but the statement is same. Exactly same in terms of case, spacing, everything. Because even if case is different or spacing is different, Oracle will consider it as a new statement. If everything is same, then yes, it saves on the parsing time. So it does not have to parse it again completely. It will do a soft parse, just confirming that this is the same statement that came earlier and I have a parsed copy of the statement already in the memory. So then it will be faster. Yes. Similar to when you have a fresh instance, your cache doesn't have anything. So statements could be slower. But as database keeps getting used, in few days the cache gets warmed up with all the usually used tables and usually used data. So then your regular queries, frequent queries starts performing better because now they are finding things in the cache. Otherwise they were going to the disk every time and getting things. Okay, what else, Rakesh?
And the correlation between the physical and the logical architecture.
Yes.
And also how to differentiate a critical and a non-critical environment.
That is important. So how do you differentiate?
See, meaning, we mentioned, right, that high availability, maximum protection, maximum performance. Through those criteria, we can actually differentiate whether it is
critical. Correct. And usually business or you will inform the DBAs about the criticality of an environment, morning Lipti. And because an environment does not become critical suddenly, it has to come from the business. Right. So on one for a full year, your environment may not be critical, but suddenly it has started becoming more used or a new important feature is planned. So now that same environment becomes critical. So you will have to inform the DBA that now this environment is critical. Can we plan for HA for this or disaster recovery for this one? And can you give us some suggestions on performance, how to get things better? Talk to your DBAs when an environment becomes critical, because unless you inform, how will they know? Because who configures HA? DBAs. Who configures DR? DBAs. So make them your friends.
And also the concept of DB replay.
Yes.
And the multi-block reading and all. So, I mean, I was not aware.
See, that is why the training is there. So that you get aware of many possibilities. DB multi-block read count. Is there an underscore between read and count, or it's a single word? I think single word. Which kind of environments is it suitable for? What kind of operations happen mostly on data warehouses? When you say large transactions, are they changes or are they reads?
Mostly reads.
So we go back to this page and also mention a small key here. OLTPs are always read writes. Data warehouses are write once and then read only. Write once because the batch, whatever is coming from OLTP, batch jobs normally load data into data warehouses. There are no single row inserts or deletes or updates. You will never do a single row inserts or deletes or updates. Not even single, but full tables also you will never change. Why do you never change? Why could you never change? See, technically you can, but you would never want to. Why?
Historical data that you are storing and you are changing the transactional data.
It is a copy of your original OLTP. So if you change something after you bring the data, it's no more your snapshot of the original. You are changing the truth. But you might argue that ETL processes change data, but they change the format of storage and few things, additional information, reducing information, but they don't change the meaning of the data. The meaning of the data will always remain exactly as it was in your OLTP, right? So,
should it be more of WORN?
Read mostly?
Read many times.
See, RO is usually used more popularly just to refer to read only. read only, RW for read write and RO for read only. So that is why we use RO. You can have your own abbreviations, that's not a problem. It's just that as long as you understand what is it, read many or read mostly, read all the time, whatever you want to call it. If you understand, that is enough. Okay, so go back to this page. And in this parameter, the name of the parameter itself has that read in it, which obviously tells you that it is for read only type of environments. Is it making sense? Are you updated from yesterday's morning stuff? Okay. Yes, Rakesh, anything else? Okay, let us give a chance to the next one.
So,
Sumana, right?
Anupama.
Anupama, sorry. Yes, Anupama.
So, out of all the topics, I think I like the first one where we understood like how the DBAs decide on what is the database block size that's required, mainly by designing.
So you don't like any other topics?
No, I said that was very interesting. That was very
okay.
interesting. Because we are usually not involved in all those things. So
right. And that is why you might think that you are getting into a DBA's realm, but you are not. Because you are the ones who should be aware what am I expecting my database to perform like. So I need to know as a developer that this is my block size. This is an ideal block size for my database. DBAs might ask you and they might not ask you. But it is developer's responsibility to inform the DBAs because they will create the database for you. So if you give them enough information, they will create a better database for you. Finally, it's a win-win for both. If it is a better database, better performing database, you will have lesser issues. They will have lesser headache of resolving issues. And they can focus more on holistic performance of the database. And you can focus more on what you really want to do. Okay. What else?
You can put plus one for everything, but the best part, what I like is the terminologies especially, because tomorrow if somebody even takes an abbreviation of this, like saying a log writer or a read writer, maybe it was like an alien topic, but now we know that, okay, what is happening from the back end and how is the processing happening, so we are able to easily relate to
correct
the things, you know? So that way I found everything.
Alright, so I'll add your plus one to the review itself. Okay, so thank you, Anupama. Yes, Vasu.
Regarding the DB block, I know that the default block size is 8 KB, but why it is 8 KB, that I can't understand. When we go for the smaller size.
And why not to choose 8 KB only all the time? That is also useful,
yes.
Hopefully. Right. Correct. Have you ever installed an Oracle database somewhere?
Yes, on Windows machine.
Right. And if you run an installation, anybody can try it. Just download from Oracle's website, Windows installer of Oracle database and try installing. So the first, second or third screen will ask you whether this database that you are trying to create, do you want it to be general purpose? General purpose is this, the dangerous one, 8K, because it's in the middle of everything. And it will ask you, other two options are transactional, which means OLTP, so it will automatically choose a smaller block size. And third option is, I think it says data warehousing in the words there, or OLAP, one of those. So it asks you, and if you choose there itself, it will automatically choose lower or higher block size compared to default. But most people do not care because it is by default, the general purpose is selected. And you, not you, but most of us are just used to saying next, next, next and install. So it just goes with all the defaults. So defaults work, but if you want to make it work better, there are a few things that we need to take care of.
And,
what happened?
Data guard and golden gate.
Yes.
Data guard and golden gate.
So data guard and Golden Gate. What's the difference? And remember, I'm not talking only to him. So he's mentioning the topics, but when I ask you something, everybody can get involved. So you don't have a right to sleep. All right. Yes, go ahead.
Golden Gate is for the cross software, like Oracle to SQL Server.
Also. So you will say it is also okay to do cross-platform, cross-versions, cross-vendors with Golden Gate. Yes. Cross software, cross vendors. So Golden Gate is very flexible, but remember that it is a replication tool. It's not a database synchronization tool. It can help with synchronization, but the automatic switch of a complete database, Golden Gate will not help. So Golden Gate is really helpful to replicate your data from anywhere to anywhere, in any direction. So, but DataGuard has a different purpose. It is a full-fledged database at another end, and you can have more than 30, 40 standbys of your primary. Each one having its own purpose, each one having its own set of users who access it. So, but DataGuard is a different thing. It does complete synchronization of the database. So in that sense, it is similar to Golden Gate, but then you can bring up the other database in 30 seconds as a full-fledged new primary database. With Golden Gate, you cannot do it. With Golden Gate, you need to get involved manually, change few things here and there, and then you can bring the other databases as a primary. What sequences? Oh, the sequence as a database object, right? Okay. I'll have to find that out because that is a very specific question on Golden Gate. Okay, I am taking a note. I will.
As of now, right, during switching, so we manually bump up the sequence on the standby database to bring the sequence next value to the more than the active server.
Okay.
So is there an automatic mechanism with a Golden Gate to manage the sequences?
I'll find it out. We'll see. Because that problem will not arise on a data guard environment. Data guard will take care of it. But in Golden Gate, you have only Golden Gate talking to the two databases. So you have sequence issues. I'll talk to you separately on understanding really what issues do you face, and then let's talk about it. Okay. What else?
And I have two questions. So usually we say that user and schema.
Yes, and it's the same thing.
Is it same or any difference? When do we call user and when do we call schema?
When you talk to people who don't know, let's say you are trying to explain database to a Narielwala. So you will tell them it's a user. Somebody who does not know technical jargon. But people who understand technology, you can tell them it's a schema. But essentially, they are the same things. So database, Oracle software sees it as a schema. But for an outsider, it is a user because every schema has a name. and that name is what you use to log in. So we call it as a user. So user and schema are the same things.
And the database parameters there is user connections, number, right?
Connections, yes. Connections parameter, right?
Yeah.
Connections parameter is allowing maximum connections to the database. Means whatever you mention there, that is what is allowed. And there is a calculation, there is a little formula on number of processes versus number of connections. So that allows you to calculate exactly how much will be allowed. So if you install a new database, you will also find another parameter called processes, and that is by default set to depending on versions, it's either set to 150 or 300. So those many different processes of that database can exist on the database server at any point of time. If you need more, then DBAs can modify those parameters and give you a little more. They do sometimes, but they need attention only if you are facing connection related issues. Like sometimes, have you ever seen TNS timed out? When you are trying to connect and then it times out, it might mean that most of the connections that are allowed on your database are already taken up by some other user connection. So now your connection is not able, it's just waiting for something to get free, and after a certain point of time it stops waiting because it decides, oh, I'm not getting anything. It's like you are standing in a queue and the queue is not moving. So at some point of time you will think that, is it worth standing? So that is when TNS timed out happens. So if that happens, talk to your DBF and get these parameters bumped up a little. So from 300, let's say they'll make it 500, and you will face lesser issues then. But it's not really related to performance, it is a connection time issue. Once you are connected, this does not have any bearing on your performance. This is just a connection time setting on the database. It may be, yeah, that may happen in Oracle. I have seen that. So Oracle normally cleans up inactive sessions. Ten minutes or something. So
they kill the session.
They can. But normally DBAs set up such procedures in agreement with the application teams that let's do this, that if you are leaving your connections and then going somewhere and coming back, we will set up a process where anything that is staying in the database for more than 10 minutes, if it is inactive, we will kill it. So if you say yes, then they will set up that procedure. But Oracle by itself also does cleanups, and when you log in the next time, you will have a new connection always, but your older sessions, not session, but connection might still be there waiting for a cleanup. But that won't cause any problems. That doesn't usually cause problems.
Something like that, right? So it's like, you know, when we are bouncing an instance, right?
Yes.
So that time it will be read.
Correct.
Right. Do we have such files at DB level also? Let's say I'm restarting the database.
If you were there when we were discussing database instance versus database, so then you will have it easier to understand. The configuration files, or you can call them parameter file, the init.ura file, is a instance level file always. Right. Now, whether your database is a standalone database, which means it has only one instance, or it is a rack database, which could mean it has multiple instances. So then the init file will exist for each instance, because every instance is on a different server. So when on another server your database needs to start up, how does it know what to start, where to start? So it needs the copy of that file on the other server also.
I have multiple instances on the same server, let's say. I have multiple users, like, in the layman. So will there be for each of the
instance?
Yeah.
Each instance will have its own init.ura file. So you will have, let's say, yesterday's example we talked about our Atlas database, right? We said DB Atlas. Let's say you have another database called DB Pluto. You were saying something?
So Atlas 1.
Oh, Atlas 1, see, you will get confused with, when you say Atlas 1, it sounds like a rack instance, first instance of the Atlas database. So that's why I didn't use a number if I am talking about standalone databases. So DB Atlas and DB Pluto are two separate databases on the server. So now you will have init DB Atlas dot ORA and one init db pluto.ora.
And both will be in Oracle home under different directories with that instance name.
It is always under Oracle home / dbs location. So all the files will lie in the same place / dbs folder. And we'll see when we get into our lab today. I'll show you. Let me mark it so that once we start our lab, I will show you this first and then we'll go further. Understanding the init file is useful, although you may not always have access to it because it needs access to the servers. And as a developer, you may not have access to the Unix level logins of the servers. But knowing that file or what is possible inside that file is useful. And there are too many parameters that you can configure. If you are interested, you can find out more about each. But there is a lot. So know whatever is very important, and that should be enough to start with. All right. Done? Okay. Samida, we'll come to that row once we are done here. Yes.
So pretty much everything for me to recall this in the past session that I attended on the database architecture, starting from OATP, OLAP, and then physical and logical instances.
Okay, so from now let's do this, that if you have a question or if you want to add something, then
yeah,
you can start. Connection, yes.
For internal storage, the quick access time is 5 microseconds, and then it's something to do with DB server. 5 microseconds, 5 milliseconds.
Yes, so disk level read write operations take 5 milliseconds, and memory level operations take microseconds. Even if you remember milliseconds and microseconds, that is enough. 5 is secondary to remember. But any disk, any memory in the world, not just Oracle. Any read-write operation. Any read-write operation. So whether it is single block, or if you remember that this special parameter DB multi-block read count. So in if you have configured this parameter, then each operation will read more blocks, right? Normally it has it happens block by block. But if you have configured this, then even with that read or write, it will still take about that much time.
Do we have any documentation in Oracle of getting provides this to both type or
which provides what?
This values where what is the rate of reading
and can you see somewhere? In AWRs. Any AWR, you generate an AWR and you will see in read, write, disk level reads, disk level writes, memory level reads, memory level writes, what are the statistics coming out of your current environment. But this is something that I inform everyone because Tom Kite has informed me. So, and and there are few other people also in Oracle's real world performance who are crazy about numbers. Not really crazy, but they depend on those because it is real data. Right? So we are not talking about stories. These are the actual numbers. So if we understand these, it is easier for us to imagine performance issues or path of an SQL. How will it happen? Why will it happen in a certain manner? And you may not find a documentation about this published by Oracle, but if you look at some other hardware related books or something that talks about disk hardware related things, you might be able to discover. But it is, this information is so scattered then that today we are talking about it all together during this training because I am aware of it. But having this information in a single place is difficult.
Because I saw this Kaio throughput and it is like 100 Mbps and 50 Mbps, so it always talks in that
That is a rate, right? So that is slightly different. But here we are talking about any operation. So, we haven't spoken about time. No, we have spoken about time, but we haven't spoken about amount of data. We are just saying any operation. So, whether it is trying to read or it is trying to write, it takes about the same time. And now you can argue that reads are faster than writes. So, that's why you have an average number in between. So it could be that a read takes 4.5 milliseconds and write takes 5.5 milliseconds. And when you average it, it comes to about 5. But good that it sparks your interest. All right, Samida, anything else? Okay, thanks. Kavita. Okay, let me create another page here for that. Cache fusion. So, do you understand what is it?
When two instances are created, like by a private interconnect, a copy is made into the other instance.
Copy of?
A copy of the memory.
What inside the memory? Blocks. So it's not a copy of the whole memory. blocks in the memory which are required by another instance or another connection, another session by a user, those blocks will be copied. So it does not copy everything, right? And don't worry, I ask you questions so that you know exactly what is happening, not to poke you, but you, when you are explaining this to a customer, they might also ask you the same things. So I just want you to be clear in your mind that when you say copy of memory, what in the memory? It is essentially the blocks, and it is never dirty blocks. Dirty blocks have no point of copying to another instance, because dirty means it has changed. So you would, have you worked with rack instances? Some of you? If you look at an AWR of a rack instance, or there are few queries also which you can run and get some statistics of a rack instance, you will find few events which start with a GC CR. Wait, GC means global cache, so it is related to cache fusion. CR always means consistent read. So whenever your blocks are copied over to another instance, they are always the undo blocks, because if there are dirty blocks on one instance, Oracle has no point in copying the dirty block because it has not even been written to the disk. So what will it copy? The older image of that block. And where is the old image? In the undo. Right, so it will copy that image of the block to another instance, and that is why it is called consistent read, GCCR related event. Okay, what else, Kavita? Full scans only.
Only for scans. So why not like why only for data warehousing? It can be used for both the OLTP. When you need,
you can use it anywhere, but you will not help OLTP with that parameter, because what is OLTP trying to do? Single row transactions or very small number of. If you need a full table, your transaction itself is a data warehousing transaction. Whenever you are doing a full table scan, means it is a data warehousing transaction. When you say OLTP, how do you define an OLTP transaction? You are looking for less than 10% of data from a table. That is when you say I am doing OLTP. If you are doing a full table scan on any table, you are doing data warehousing, whether you call that database as data warehouse or not.
But in OLTP also there would be batches running every night, which will like, let's say there is a, like, you know, telecom database where we have to give some value added services.
Mm-hmm.
We have to, like, there is a batch, right, which is going to take all the subscriber and apply 10 rupees charges. So it's a transaction which is like, you know, which is applied to all the subscriber base, right? So
okay.
So it's like, you know, even though it is OLTP, but it is applying to the whole subscriber base. So those kind of batches will always be there.
It can be, but then you are splitting it by time. So your OLTP or your data warehousing batch updates would never run in the same time as OLTP. You are splitting the time. Because if you try to run a batch update during the OLTP time, they will conflict with each other, means one of those will suffer. And what is more important, having a transaction run quickly or run that batch in the night? So batches are normally run in off business hours just to make sure that your OLTP is not affected. Why should OLTP not be affected? Because of time, because it needs everything to happen very quickly, less than seconds. If you introduce a batch somewhere in between, then OLTP will not be able to run. So it does happen, and I think we spoke about it yesterday, that either you separate your OLTP and data warehouses by actual database separation or actual schema separation, user level separation, or split it by time. So in the daytime you run your OLTP, and in the night there are few batch jobs that run on some of the objects, which either load data or run some updates like this, what you just mentioned. But then at that time, you don't want any other OLTP type operations running. Okay, what else?
What are direct reads?
One second, OLTP versus data warehouse. Split by time or database. Okay.
What are direct reads?
Okay, that's a new thing. I will park it for now. Right now we are trying to talk about what we have done already. All right, but I'll mark it. Let's come back to this once we are done. All right. Anything else? Okay, Praveen. Block size?
Yeah, block size and then disk drives, memory drives, and how we can do the scalability for instances. So those are interesting. And one additional topic which I was which I think we can cover is this VGA and how it's really included in the performance.
Yeah, that is included already, so we will do it. That's for future. Any, that's it? Okay, Harsha?
The importance of block size and OLTP, OLAP, and physical and logical difference between physical and logical.
Mm-hmm.
And it's an RS where we to convert the table space into table set. This is the RS where we do. Why we should not go for indexes in data warehousing tables?
Any indexes? Or
primarily if you can foreign keys because of the relations we need to use. So that
primary key and foreign key should be there. Other indexes could be removed slowly based on your testing. So let a test tell you that you don't need an index and then drop it. In SGA,
yeah.
There are a few more things like your parsed copy of the statements, and I think Anupama mentioned that a few minutes ago about parsed copy of an SQL. So once an SQL comes to the database, first time it comes, it will take time to parse the statement and store a copy of that parsed statement in the memory. So that is also stored in the SGA. So we will, but that's a good question. In the SGA, you have the database buffer cache, which is the storage for all the blocks that we were talking about since yesterday, or that all the data blocks that we were talking about since yesterday go here. Then you have shared pool. Shared pool is an area which contains that parsed copy of statements and few more things, but that is a separate area within the SGA. Then there are few more. So there are many components: library pool, Java pool, large pool. Each one has their own purpose. For example, large pool is very useful when Oracle's backups run. So So RMAN, if you have heard of Recovery Manager, RMAN uses the large pool to run its backups against a database. So configuring large pool a little bit differently can make the backups also very efficient. But that's a DBA thing. You don't have to worry about it. But these two, the buffer cache and the shared pool, are the main ones that developers should be aware of. So next time the same statement comes, then it finds the parsed statement. If it is the same type of statement, even with different values, and it saves a little time on parsing. So when it actually parses, it is called a hard parse. And when it just finds the parse statement already existing in the memory, that is called a soft parse. And we will generate our own AWRs. You can bring AWRs like we discussed yesterday. You are going to bring AWR from some environment, right?
Yeah.
Exadata environment?
Yeah.
Correct. So we will analyze that during our class, hopefully tomorrow. So I'll point out there are many things to understand just from the AWR. There are so many things that you can understand about a database just by looking at the AWR of a significant time. So let's say your database is busy during 9 a.m. to 10 a.m. of a Monday or of every day. So if you have captured an AWR for that time, then it is useful to look at it. All right, what else, Harsha? Yes. Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you, Harsha. Okay. Yes.
So if we have multiple block sizes, so what would be the value of that parameter, DB block size parameter? Will it still show the default block size, or do we have a new parameter for
DB? Okay. DB block size parameter always shows what you have chosen at the time of creation. So based on your initial calculations, if you have chosen 4K as the initial one, DB block size will always be 4K, which means any object that you create, unless you move it to a specific table space which has larger block sizes or different block size, that object will always have the original DB block size blocks, same block size as the DB block size. But after creation, or even during creation, if you mention the other table spaces which have larger block sizes, then it will go into that block size. But the parameter you are talking about will always have one value, which is at the time of creation. Let me mention that here. What was that? Yes.
And wanted to know more about the how the compression of the memory will impact the performance. Like SCA, PGA. So what is the feasible size for each of the components and what is its impact on the performance?
Perfect. So we will get all of that when we are studying AWRs. AWR branches into many different topics. In addition to just looking at the existing performance, existing loads performance, it will also help us with PGA resizing, SGA resizing, many advices that are available from Oracle. So yeah, we'll get there. What else? Okay, thank you, Raghavendra.
U plus one. All the sessions
are okay. Perfect. So that's the easiest one to do. Ram. Yep. Okay.
Thank you, Raj. Perfect. Okay, so another plus one here. Rahul?
Almost all topics were new for me, Golden Gates and all.
Right.
Other than that, DB blocks and all were familiar.
Lipti? Yeah, you can find out. There is a view in the database called v$instance and v$database. If you have access to those, you can use v$instance to find out which instance are you connected to. Right. If you do not have access to it, ask for an AWR. From the DBA. If you have access to generate your own AWR, good. AWR itself has on the top, it says, is it a rack or not? And I'll show you, when we get to the AWRs, we will generate our own AWR. You will realize that there is, on the top of the AWR itself, it says rack, yes or no. So from there also you know, and it also shows all the rack servers, rack instances, names also. So there are ways to figure it out. What else?
I don't know whether you guys have discussed it yesterday, but I read something about pluggable database. So
okay.
What is actually that?
Okay. That is interesting, and we haven't discussed it yet because initially, unless we understand the basic architecture, pluggable is a advanced topic. So I did not want to bring it up till now. Now that you have mentioned it, how many of you have worked with pluggable databases? Anybody? We have in our labs, we have all of it. We have pluggable, we have non-pluggable, we have 12c, we have 11g. So we will try as much as we can, as long as it is related to performance. But there are, see, pluggable itself is not related to performance, but the need for it has come because of that only. So let me describe it to you in few minutes. When you install an Oracle software, if you have installed Oracle software anywhere in the world, Oracle has a standard download that you download for Windows, Linux, any operating system, let's say Unix. Once you install an Oracle database, and you also install an Oracle database of the same version on your machine and your machine, is it the same? Is it going to look the same for both of you right after you install? If it is the same version? Host is, see, I am talking about the installation. Is the installation going to look the same? If you install Microsoft Word on your system versus on his system, does Word work the same?
Yes.
Initially.
Yes.
Right, later on you can configure things which start making your software behave differently, right? But right at the time of install, it's the same, correct? So that is the base image of the software. When you install versus you install versus she installs versus he installs, everywhere it is going to look the same, right? Now, as you create more users in the database, which are schemas, each user creates its own tables, indexes, depending on whatever applications they are working on. So you have application 1, application 2, 3, 4, so on. In the same database, let's say you have 5 separate users for 5 separate applications. And over 6 months or an year, they have created their own objects. So now the database has changed. So now your database versus what he used it. In his database, maybe he had 3 users. For you, you have created 5 users, and each user has its own data. So now the image has changed of Oracle's database. Now, if there is a new application which needs a new database, they do not want the same database to be used. They want a new separate database. They don't want any connection with anybody else. So you will again install Oracle. This base image will come again. And they will create their own users inside. So now this base image is same as the previous, as long as it's the same version. So now what Oracle is doing with 12c, if it knows that the base image is always the same, why do you want to have multiple copies of it on the same server? So what they have done is, they say that I'll install my base image once, and we'll call it as root. It's just a root area of Oracle database. And now whatever you want to create, each one will use the base image. So think of it, have you used DBMS functions? Like DBMS output, DBMS mail, or you can say DBMS SMTP, and so many. Where are these functions physically located? They are owned by Sys, and where are they physically located? In the data storage, which we saw yesterday. So essentially, they are part of the base image, correct? In this picture, where are they? They are in the base image. It is supplied by Oracle, correct? So they will always exist, whether you install, whoever installs Oracle. So now what Oracle has done is, we call the base images container database, CDB, and then for users to create their own data, DBAs will create pluggable databases for you. Pluggable databases contain only user data, nothing else. So now inside pluggable database, if you are running a DBMS output or DBMS, any of those functions, it picks from here. So it's simply using the copy of those functions, procedures which are supplied by Oracle from the base image. It does not have anything of its own. It is simply connected there. So think of a building, a big building with different flats in it. The big building is the CDB, the container database, and each flat simply uses the building for its power and lift and stairs and everything, but each flat is independent. Each flat has its own things to do. Each flat has its own users to connect.
So in this case, we can use the user defined library. If suppose I created a user defined library in the base base database,
you
can use in other users.
Whenever a user connects to this architecture, you are always connecting to only PDBs.
Oh. So connect to that base.
You don't have to. CDB does not have anything. CDB is simply the original Oracle's base image. So DBAs will log into CDB or PDB anywhere. But as a user, you will always connect only to PDBs.
So whenever I'm accessing any system defined function, it is actually connecting to the CDB and providing me. It's just that we will not.
It's just under it. So let's say you came out of your flat. You don't have to connect to your building to use the stairs, right? Stairs are there. You are came out of a flat and you start using the stairs. That's how it is. So if you are using the DBMS supplied functions or even some average, there are hundreds of functions which are supplied by Oracle, right? So whenever you are using them, it is actually using it from the base image. Yes.
Connected to PDB, how it interconnected to CDB, how it works.
This is how it works. So all the user data is in pluggable database.
And this is by
metadata is still in CDB.
What?
User metadata still in
CDB. Nothing is in CDB. Everything is in PDB. Only what was supplied by Oracle originally, which will never change. You will never change what is in the CDB. So that is why it is called root. That will never change. And whatever new that you are doing is always happening only within the PDB.
And this is configured by the DBs when we are creating this or during installation time it automatically.
During installation time, DBAs choose to create PDB CDB configuration or non-CDB configuration, which means a normal till today, whatever you were doing, traditional style of databases, DBAs have the choice to create either this way or this way.
I think in after
19C, only the container database and database is mandatory. This is going to retire. Oh, CDB PDB is mandatory. Huh, that will happen.
What are the benefits?
Because, okay, so now. First benefit is you can see right here that every time you need a new database, you don't have a need for a new copy of the base image, which takes up space, which takes up its own resources, which takes up CPU, memory on the servers. It's not required. And statistically, with benchmarks, if with traditional architecture you were able to support say 50 databases on a server, on the same server, same box, with CDB PDB architecture on the same box, you just reinstall the software and now you are able to run 250 of the same types of databases, just because the consumption of resources has been centralized. Because not every database is as active as everything else, right? So why do you want same amount of resources for every new database? You don't.
And in case if one of the user wants an upgrade in the Oracle version, then the CDB would change, right? The base image. So,
So what will you upgrade is the CDB.
Yes.
So what will you do? Let's say this is a 12.101 and you want to upgrade to 12.102. All right, one of the PDBs. So this is 1, 2, 3, 4. First one wants to upgrade to 12.102. So what the DBA has to do is create a new CDB with 12.102. This is a fresh CDB, completely different from the original, and now this CDB can have any number of PDBs again. So pluggable database, the word has come up because you can simply unplug from here and plug it there. It's like a USB drive, you can think of it as a USB drive. So unplug, plug. So because user data doesn't have versions, what has versions? Can you think of it? Base image. And why does it have a version? Because of the executables. So executables have their versions, right? So when you want the user data to use a new version, in the user data itself there is no executable. So that is why you can simply unplug and plug into another CDB, because version is changing only at the CDB level, not PDB level. It's better. That's why you are able to support 250 databases instead of 50.
On the user, on the PDBs. Perform better than traditional databases?
Yes, because of less resource usage. But see, I am not saying that the same query that use. It is related to what was Rakesh talking about in the morning, an hour ago. Because of rack, from a standalone environment, you move to a rack. That always will not mean that a specific query's performance will improve. So when you move to a PDB, your queries will still perform as they were performing in the original databases. But now, more things are able to happen, just because you are consuming lesser resources total. So now you will be able to run more on the same environment. So that way you can call it as a performance improvement, but it is essentially scalability concern. You are able to do more with the same. Yes, you had a question?
So in the S3 scenarios where we have Atlas 1 and Atlas 2, same Atlas 1 is a CDB and it has two pluggable databases. And if I create another instance, so it will be again another CDB and another two pluggable databases?
In rack?
Yeah, in rack.
Yes. So, see, everything that is concerned with executables is at the CDB level. So rack is a new instance, right, on a separate server, which means it needs new executables on the other side, which means in a rack environment also you will have a complete CDB and all of the PDBs similar to your first instance. Okay, let us take a break. Let us take a break.